Naomi and I had the pleasure of going to Iceland this summer. And so the reason I went to Iceland as a geologist is to have the pleasure of standing right on a plate boundary. So I'll get into all that. But I also hope kind of what comes through in this talk is just some of the other amazing things about Iceland that I had no idea of or very little idea. It really is an incredible place. And my hope would be that everybody gets to go to Iceland. Maybe we need to do a Mesa College trip to Iceland. Okay, so just kind of in terms of what I'm going to cover tonight, I'm going to begin by talking about the central paradigm in all of geology. It's known as plate tectonic theory. And as you'll see, our understanding of Iceland is really shaped by plate tectonic theory and the fact that Iceland straddles what geologists refer to as a divergent plate boundary. So I'll kind of set the stage in terms of the plate tectonic setting of Iceland, and that'll kind of set us up for everything else. And so one of the things that we got to do when we were in Iceland is actually descend 600 feet down inside of a volcano. It's the only place in the world where you can do that. So I'll talk about that a little bit. One of the great surprises, to me anyway, about Iceland were all of the waterfalls. I really had no idea before I went to Iceland what an amazing place it is in terms of diversity of waterfalls. So I'll show you hopefully some cool pictures of waterfalls that I took, and also talk a little bit about the kind of the geologic features around waterfalls and sort of the geologic processes that shape the formation of waterfalls. And also, owing to the fact that Iceland straddles a plate boundary, it's a volcanically active region, one of the most volcanically active regions on Earth. And so I'll have a little bit to say about geysers and other geothermal landforms. And then I'll kind of finish up with just some brief comments about the reason why Iceland got its name, namely its ice sheets and glaciers and glacial landforms. Earth itself is a planet we can think of as divided into three broad layers. And from the outside in, we have the uppermost layer. It's called the crust. It's thinner, relatively speaking, than the shell of an egg. If you shrink the Earth down to the size of an egg, the Earth's crust would be thinner than the shell of the egg. And then below that is Earth's most volumetric layer, that's known as the mantle. Very different than the crust, it turns out. And then down at about half the radius of the Earth, things change yet again very dramatically. Whereas the crust and the mantle are rocky, primarily, the core, both the inner and the outer core, are metallic. They're composed primarily of liquid and solid iron, a little bit of nickel, and some other things. So that's sort of the big picture. But as far as kind of setting us up for a brief discussion about plate tectonic theory, what's important about all this is it turns out that as far as the behavior of the plates go, the crust and the upper mantle essentially are stuck together and they behave as one. And that oneness is what geologists call the lithosphere. And when I teach geology, I get on my students for referring to the plates as crustal plates. They're really not crustal plates because for the most part, the crust almost never moves independently of the underlying mantle. It really is the crust and the underlying mantle that move together as one. They both exhibit brittle behavior. So it allows this outer shell to kind of break up into a series of these continent-sized slabs of rock that we call plates. Here's a map of Earth's main lithospheric plates. The plates are, you know, on the order of maybe 100 to 200 kilometers in thickness, and they slide around atop this kind of more mobile, plasticky interior, roughly speaking, at about the rate that your fingernails grow. There's Iceland. It straddles a major plate boundary. This feature that we're going to talk a lot about tonight is known as the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, and it's an example of what geologists call a divergent or plate boundary. Iceland, it's a pretty high latitude island. It just sits outside the Arctic Circle. The main landmass of Iceland doesn't actually extend into the Arctic Circle, but it gets close. Some of the offshore islands just north of Iceland do kind of cross that 66.5 degree latitude boundary. One of the central messages of plate tectonic theory is that the plates, these continent-sized slabs of rock, can really only interact in three fundamental ways. They can move apart. That's called a divergent boundary, and that dominates the geology of Iceland. They can also move together. That's called a convergent boundary, and they can slip sideways, kind of like opposing lanes of traffic on the freeway. That's called a transform boundary. So let me just show you a quick animation of these three plate boundary types, just so you kind of get a sense of kind of what's happening in three dimensions. So there's a divergent boundary. This is how all of the Earth's ocean basins form when continents split apart to create new ocean basins. This is an example of a particular type of convergent boundary. It's called a subduction zone. And then finally, the plate boundary that we have about 90 or 100 miles east of us along the San Andreas Fault, that's called a transform boundary. Okay, here's a Google Earth image. And you probably heard, you know, it's certainly true that in some ways Iceland and Greenland are misnamed, and you can kind of see why, right? Iceland, as you'll see, is quite green, especially in the summertime. Not really true for Greenland. But in any case, there's Iceland, kind of in the middle of the North Atlantic, kind of west of Norway, Sweden, etc. So Iceland, as a landmass, it was settled surprisingly late. Probably around the 800s or the 900s, and it was settled not by Vikings, it turns out, but by Norwegian farmers. They went there to find a kind of pristine farmland. But one of the interesting things I learned about Iceland is that when the first Norse settlers got there, according to some historical documents, they found, of all things, Irish monks living in Iceland. So kind of interesting. So there's the plate boundary. This is a structure that we've known about for several decades. It's called the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And boy, the big reason why geologists in general love Iceland, and the big reason that I wanted to go to Iceland, it's essentially the only place on Earth where the mid-ocean ridge sticks up above sea level, and you can walk across and inside and across to the other side of the mid-ocean ridge without ever getting your feet wet. So that's pretty spectacular for that reason. It turns out that's a bit of a fiction, but I'll get to that in a minute. So there's the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. This is the North American plate. The plates, by the way, are so well established that we often give them names. So guess which continent the North American plate was named after? Eurasia, right? That's why we call it the North American plate. So we have the North American plate kind of moving westward with respect to the Eurasian plate. A quick point about frame of reference here. So it's tempting, in this case, to sort of imagine that the plate boundary is stationary and it's only the plates that move. And it's also tempting to think that the North American plate is truly moving west and the Eurasian plate is truly moving east. But you know, if you've had any physics at all, right, you know that the next question you always want to ask is, well, with respect to what? And it turns out that plate motions, in this case, are only relative. And so all that's being implied by these arrows here is that the North American plate is generally moving westward with respect to the Eurasian plate. So we're not really making any kind of an absolute statement about how the plates are moving, on this diagram anyway, say with respect to a stationary point in Earth's center, that the plate boundary motions would look different if we did that. Okay, so kind of zooming into to the island of Iceland a little bit, there's the divergent boundary where the two plates are separating. And let me just show you a quick animation here. This kind of just gives you a better visual sense of kind of really the fundamental process controlling the formation of Iceland. At the surface, the oldest rock in Iceland is about 16 million years old, and it's thought that in the subsurface, we probably would find rock on the order of maybe 24 million years old or so. What I want to discuss now is kind of a modification of plate tectonic theory. So plate tectonic theory, again, proposes that the Earth's outer shell is broken up into these brittle slabs that move around a mobile interior. And plate tectonic theory was developed surprisingly late. It really wasn't until about the mid-1960s that it was developed into full-fledged form, although there were kind of earlier versions dating back to late 1800s, early 1900s. But, you know, more than just kind of one idea among many, something I really want to emphasize about how plate tectonic theory relates to Iceland and all of geology, it's not just one idea among many in geologic science, it really is the central organizing paradigm or model. I sometimes like to compare plate tectonic theory and geoscience with what evolutionary did for biological science. It really is the central model around which we frame all our thinking about the Earth's outer shell. But as with all scientific theories, plate tectonic theory only takes us so far in that it doesn't really help us understand what's happening deeper down in the mantle, perhaps near the core mantle boundary. And about the same time that plate tectonic theory comes in line, in maybe the mid-1960s, there was a completely separate model known as mantle plume theory that was developed at about the same time by some of the same people who developed plate tectonic theory. And the essence of mantle plume theory is that it kind of depends, maybe anywhere from half a dozen to a couple of dozen places on Earth. There may be places in the lower mantle, perhaps as deep as the core mantle boundary, where the rock is either a different composition or perhaps hotter than the surrounding mantle, such that you get these cylindrical columns that kind of rise buoyantly up through the mantle. And so hence the term mantle plume. A good way to kind of envision a mantle plume is like rising smoke from a cigarette or from a fire. What we now know is that the plumes are by no means stationary. They kind of wiggle around a little bit on geologic timescales. Something that's long puzzled geologists, even with the advent of plate tectonic theory, is how come in Iceland we find the only place in the world where we have an island that rises up above sea level that also straddles a divergent plate boundary. What that seems to indicate is that the volcanism is especially productive at that one spot on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And so one strength of plume theory is that this might help us understand why Iceland exists. It's not simply that Iceland straddles a divergent plate boundary. It really is more the case that we have kind of an overlapping divergent boundary that sits directly atop one of these kind of slow jets of material called a mantle plume. So maybe the best way to think of Iceland is in terms of plate divergence atop a mantle plume. You really kind of need both ideas probably to understand the geology of Iceland. All right, so what about these plumes? You know, the first thing I should say is that Earth's interior is like a gigantic black box. It's notoriously difficult to really understand what's happening down hundreds to thousands of kilometers inside the mantle. It's not as if we can take a direct image. And so how do we do that? Well, one of the best ways to, in effect, image the mantle or give us information about the Earth's mantle is through the study of earthquakes. So if you imagine an earthquake that happens someplace, probably higher up than actually is shown on this diagram, the Earth's crust, an earthquake just represents a catastrophic break and subsequent release of pulsing earthquake waves. And so as these waves travel through the mantle, depending on the strength properties of the mantle that they traverse, the waves either speed up or they slow down. These are elastic waves, and so their velocity, their speed, is going to be controlled by the elastic properties of the mantle. And what geophysicists have long noticed is that if you sort of track the motion of an earthquake wave as it travels through the mantle, and you do this for many earthquake waves, there seem to be places where earthquake waves arrive later than expected. So here's our earthquake. It's traveling in some pathway that we have to guess at or work out. Here's when the wave arrives. That's what we know. We know when the earthquake happens, and we know when the wave arrives. We can make inferences about the path that the wave must have to traverse in between the time that it originates after earthquake center, called the focus, and when the seismic wave arrives. But what's interesting is that when you do that for hundreds or thousands of different wave pathways, you can map out these three-dimensional regions in the mantle that seem to be, they seem to slow down seismic waves. And so right here, this wave is arriving later than we would expect it to. And what that seems to indicate is there probably are regions in the mantle, either because they're hotter or they're of a differing composition than the surrounding mantle, that retard the velocity of seismic waves. By the way, this technology is known as seismic tomography, and it's essentially the same thing that your doctor would do when they perform a CAT scan. And so in effect, we're taking a gigantic CAT scan of the Earth's interior. And imagine if you do this in three dimensions, it turns out it's possible to map out these kind of globby cylindrical structures that some evidence indicates may originate as deep as the coromantle boundary in these so-called ultra-low velocity zones. These are kind of pancake-shaped features that seem to sort of sit there passively on top of the the metallic core. So all this is to say that's kind of the basic model of Icelandic geology. We have both plate divergence and a mantle plume. What we're looking at here is an actual tomographic image published in the peer-reviewed Interior. And so in this case, what the red colors represent are slower than expected wave arrivals. So these are negative velocity anomalies. You can see the negative numbers. And it's just a choice of researchers to kind of color the slower than expected wave velocities red, because the implication is that in many mantle plumes, if not most mantle plumes, the waves are slowed down because the mantle is hotter in that region than the surrounding region. So a lot of researchers think of these as thermal structures that may originate as deep as the coromantle boundary. So you can see, in this case, the tomographic evidence indicates that the mantle plume beneath Iceland is not this simple vertical cylinder. It's not an elevator. It kind of wiggles around and appears to be somewhat bent beneath Iceland. So there's kind of my outline of the plume. We can do this on more of a global scale as well. There's Hawaii. The Big Island of Hawaii is also thought to be underlain by a mantle plume. I want to really emphasize in this complicated diagram that we're not looking at an image of Earth's interior. This is obviously not a photograph. It's one interpretation based on a whole bunch of really complicated seismic wave velocity data. But what it seems to indicate is we have these kind of low velocity fingers throughout the mantle, some of which may be these kind of rising jets of hotter than normal material. That would explain kind of the greater than expected volcanism that we see in Iceland. Okay, so kind of zooming into to Iceland, if you look at the divergent plate boundary, it kind of comes on shore here in what's known as the northern volcanic zone and the northern rift zone, and then in kind of central Iceland, it kind of splits up into two segments. And it's thought that the mantle plume is right here under the Vatnajökull ice cap. But what's interesting is that there's good evidence that between about 15 and 24 million years ago, the plate boundary, which is essentially right here, used to be right here. And then the geologic evidence is that between 7 and 15 million years ago, the plate boundary jumped to the southeast. And then just in the last 3 or 4 million years, it jumped yet again to its current position. And it may even be that in current geologic time, the plate boundary is also in the process of jumping into the eastern rift zone. We get a lot of volcanism in here, as well as sort of the main plate boundary in the western zone. So this brings us back to the idea that the best way to think about plate tectonic movements is not simply that the plates move and the boundaries are stationary. So it's not this. Everything is moving. There's nothing on the surface of the Earth that isn't stationary. So the best way to imagine what's going on in three dimensions is to imagine that not only are the plates moving, but the boundary between the plates is moving as well. So maybe a way to illustrate that is instead of just my standing still and doing this, if I walk at the same time and I do this, notice that both the boundary and the plates are moving. So what may have been the case is that perhaps these mid-ocean ridges, in this case, in the case of Iceland, form directly atop the Icelandic plume. And then because the ridge itself migrates, after a while it kind of moves off the plume. And then it's thought possibly that the plume is the reason why we have a divergent plate boundary there in the first place. Because all of this hot material is sort of rising up from below, sort of pushing up the lithosphere and cracking it and initiating the divergent plate boundary. So the idea is that as things move, you sort of crack a new plate boundary in the current location of the plume, and then as time goes by, if the plate boundary itself migrates off of the plume, that plate boundary will eventually be deactivated and a new plate boundary will form in the current position of the plume. So that's sort of the basic geologic model that, that kind of guides our understanding of Iceland. Everything is moving, in other words, not just the plates, but the plate boundaries. And there's our eastward migrating plate boundary. The geologists in the audience will recognize this map. This is a very famous map created by a now very famous geoscientist, Marie Tharp, in the late 1950s. And what was so striking about it, we'd sort of vaguely known about the presence of these mid-ocean ridges for a long time, but based on sonar data and soundings, she was able to create in the late 50s a more detailed map of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge than had ever existed. Two things are of note on this map. First of all, the central ridge that kind of sticks up maybe a kilometer or two above the seafloor, but even more impressively, we get this sort of central cleft, this central downdropped region right in the center of the ridge. That's known as the Axial Valley or the Rift Valley. And so I got to tell you, to a geologist, there's no question at all what's happening within the Rift Valley. This feature right here is known as a graben. And I learned from one of my colleagues that the word graben comes from the German word for grave. And so what's happening here is we have cracks here and here, kind of on either side of the graben, and the central region of the graben is being downdropped. There's no question that that's happening. We've known about this overall process for hundreds of years. And so when geologists first saw this kind of central downdropped graben, right where you'd expect the ridge to be the tallest, that was a dead giveaway that this section of seafloor is being pulled apart in tension. We can demonstrate in the lab that if you take a slab of rock and you pull it apart in tension, you'll develop this central downdropped graben. So really compelling evidence in this case, as early as the 1950s, that the Earth's outer shell is being pulled apart in tension here. And the reason I'm kind of going into this is in the next few slides, I'm going to show you actual examples where you can walk through and into and across this very structure where it sticks up above sea level in Iceland. So there we go. This is Thingvellir National Park. This is the reason I went to Iceland, to have the thrill of walking down into the Rift Valley that I just showed you and out the other side. So here's the boundary. There's the Rift Valley. This is the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, and presumably, you know, you can hike down to the bottom and literally right straddle the plate boundary. How cool is that? You can have 1 foot on the North American plate and the other foot on the Eurasian plate. Except that it's not really true. But it's fun to sort of think that it's true, even for geologists. So there's the North American plate. There's the plate boundary. And there's the Eurasian plate. We know by now that the two plates are being pulled apart in tension. That's why you get all the volcanism you do in Iceland. As you pull apart the Earth's outer shell, that decompresses the mantle and melts it. The mantle in this case, except for maybe where the plume is, isn't melting because it's hotter. It's melting because it's being decompressed, it's being depressurized. That turns solid rock into liquid magma, liquid rock. It wells up because of its buoyancy and then spills out into the rift. So the next few slides, the next few photos I'm going to show you are sort of close-up photographs that I took when our group kind of walked down into the Rift Valley and out the other side. So this first photograph is going to be me kind of standing on the edge of the path looking south, kind of into the rift. The second photograph is a little footbridge down there, literally right on the boundary. And then the third photograph are these subsidiary rifts that I'll show you. Okay, well, why is this a fiction a little bit? It's a fiction because at this scale, plate boundaries are wide. So the plate boundary in Thingvellir Valley in Iceland is maybe, 20, 30 kilometers wide. So what that means is there's no single point where you can stand and say that you're actually, standing on the plate boundary. These are kind of wide features. And this technically is not the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. It's one of dozens of individual breaks along this wider kind of plate boundary zone. But it's one of the deeper breaks, and it's one of the best developed breaks. And so so that's why it's fun to kind of go to Iceland and sort of pretend you're straddling the plate boundary. Okay, so here I am on the plate boundary, I guess just off the side of the plate boundary, looking south here. So what do you think, knowing what you know already about Iceland, what do you make of these sort of tall, sort of conical mountains? What do you think we're looking at here? Volcanoes, obviously. Makes sense, right? We're pulling the plates apart, decompressing the mantle. All of this molten rock is welling up. In fact, on all sides, 360 degrees in Thingvellir, we have volcanoes. That's exactly what plate tectonic theory would predict. So just to give you a sense of scale, there are some people in the bottom, you can kind of see them. So that cliff, this side of the graben, is several tens of meters tall, and then we have another fault on the other side, so this entire central area is kind of dropping down to form the rift valley, also known as the graben. And then these are a couple of colleagues. This is down at the bottom, so you can see the Eurasian plate over here, and the North American plate over there. It's even damaged the fence there. Right? Not really. to imagine that might be the case. And there's the plate boundary. Look at that. And this is off to the side a little bit. And these are just subsidiary rifts. Again, the plate boundary consists of dozens, if not hundreds, of these individual cracks that collectively form the plate boundary in Iceland. I didn't get a chance to do this on this visit, but something I definitely plan to do on the next visit. It turns out there are tour companies that will take you scuba diving in that lake that I showed you, literally right on the ridge and right within the rift. So this is not something I did, but it's a YouTube video that I grabbed. It's kind of fun. I wanted to show you what it looks like to scuba dive atop a divergent plate boundary.
Okay, we are here at Silver Lake. We are essentially here on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And we're going to go and dive and touch two continents.
So there's one of those rifts that I showed you. So how cool would that be? So that would be the logical next step. You know, once you've walked across the plate boundary, why not go scuba diving on the plate boundary? By the way, this is just for illustration purposes. I don't actually know that that's truly the Eurasian plate. So the next thing that we did, actually this was before the trip started, we went with a kind of a tour group, is we got to actually descend inside a volcano within the Western Volcanic Zone. About a 30-minute drive outside of Reykjavik, the capital of Iceland, essentially the only city in Iceland. So what I'm going to show you is the experience of being lowered inside the Þingvellir volcano. Okay, so this is the Þingvellir volcano. Yes, I practiced that for months, and I still can't say it right. Icelandic is notoriously difficult to pronounce. Any native Icelandic speakers in the audience? Okay, good. So you won't know how much I'm butchering Icelandic language. So this is a common type of volcano. It's known as a cinder cone. And did I mention it was a helicopter tour, by the way? So we were all in individual helicopters. But there's the volcano. And so what you do is, you know, you pay money to the tour company. They pick you up in Reykjavik, and you travel about, what, half an hour, 45 minutes. And then you walk maybe 2 or 3 kilometers across this lava field to the base camp. And then they kind of outfit you with harnesses and helmets, et cetera. And it sounded pretty easy, but I got to tell you, that was the longest 3 kilometers that we ever walked. On the day that we did this tour, boy, the weather in Reykjavik was beautiful. It was 60 degrees, sunny skies. I didn't realize that we'd be going up into the mountains above Reykjavik. And by the time we got there, it was almost blizzard conditions. It wasn't actually snowing, but the temperature was maybe, what, 30 or 35 degrees. And the wind was blowing. It was foggy. You couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And so by the time we got to base camp, we were cold and tired. And so they gave us some hot soup, kind of warmed us up. So a pretty small volcano as far as volcanoes go. It's called a cinder cone. This is it's described as a dormant volcano. I don't know if I'm completely comfortable with that term as a geologist. It last erupted on the order of 4,000 years ago. As far as I'm concerned, it's still active. But what's somewhat unique about it is the plumbing system underneath the volcano is completely emptied of molten rock. It's essentially an excavated magma chamber. And it's the thing that got me in terms of the marketing for this tour is they mentioned that this is the only place on Earth where you can descend inside a volcano. And they also mentioned that fewer people have done this tour than have been to the top of Mount Everest. So I thought that sounded pretty cool. Until I started looking into it, and it turns out so many people have been to the top of Mount Everest, it's actually not that impressive a claim. Still, it's pretty cool to be lowered inside a volcano. So there's base camp. Okay, and then just another quick video clip has kind of some nice imagery that I want to show you.
Threatening the gate of a volcanic magma chamber, only a 30-minute drive from Reykjavik and a short hike across a magical lava landscape, is the only place on the planet where humans can descend into a volcano.
They mentioned that this apparatus that they're using to lower people down is essentially the same thing they use on skyscrapers to watch windows.
This is a unique journey of discovery that you won't experience anywhere else in the world. In the massive cathedral vault, which is 120 meters deep, the vibrant colors and the sheer size of this 4,000-year-old magma chamber is truly breathtaking. Experience a unique journey into the Earth.
This is just an image to kind of give you a sense of scale. There's the Statue of Liberty for scale. So from base camp, it's about a 10-minute walk up to the summit of the cinder cone, and then you're lowered down. It just takes, you know, just a few minutes, 6 or 8 minutes to get down to the bottom. Then you kind of hang out right in this area for about half an hour. So they don't give you too much time down there, but it's kind of a small space. There's really not too much to do down there other than kind of trip out.
Yes.
So the next slide is I'm going to show you kind of what the entrance looks like. So again, about a 10-minute walk from base camp, and this person clipped us in, and then we kind of walked down on this plank and then climbed down onto the lift, which actually took us down inside the volcano. Here is our guide. He kept us safe on the journey down. And then there we are at base camp with our harnesses and hard hats and headlamps. So this is a picture I actually took. So at this point, I'm down in the bottom on the floor of the magma chamber, looking up with my camera up the volcanic conduit, and another group is coming down. They would kind of cycle groups in and out every few minutes. And some geologically, I wanted to mention, does that conduit look completely round? It's sort of squashed, isn't it? And that's very typical of the sorts of eruptions that you see in these kind of smallish volcanoes called cinder cones. Typically what happens is these sheet-like intrusions of magma called dikes sort of work their way up. And at the surface, you get extensional cracks that open up. And then very often in the early stages of an eruption like this, you get a whole curtain of lava that shoots up several hundred meters into the air, sometimes called a curtain of fire. We see this all the time in Hawaii on shield volcano eruptions. And then very often what will happen as the eruption proceeds is the curtain of fire will kind of die down, and then the main locus of volcanism will concentrate at a point. And on time scales of maybe hours to days to weeks, molten rock will shoot up into the air, typically not too high, no more than a kilometer to very most. And because it's not really a violently explosive eruption, and the particles are pea to walnut size, they're not that small actually, they fall back down to Earth and they kind of create this gigantic anthill right above the erupted conduit. So that anthill is the Thringegeer volcano. So these are some images that I took down in the volcano. They do have some lighting, but these are not colored lights. And we're seeing all the colors here, because what's happening is as the as things are happening in the magma chamber, the wall rock is interacting with gases that are dissolving from the lava and kind of altering the side rock chemically. And there's Naomi looking at the rock like a geologist. And so here we are. Here's another group about ready. I don't know if they're coming up or going down. One of the other things that was interesting on both the descent and also the trip back up is in some places the conduit is so small that the lift sort of scrapes against the side, and the guide has to sort of push the lift away from the side to keep it from getting caught up along the side. And so I took this picture. This is literally, you know, 3 or 4 feet in front of my face, and you can really see the sort of the planar sort of sheet-like structure of the dike that formed the conduit for the Thringegeer volcano. All right, well, the next place I'm going to take you is to an amazing black sand beach just outside of a tiny village in southern Iceland called Vik. So this is right along the coast. This offshore spire is known as a sea stack, and what it indicates to geologists is that the coastline literally used to stick out this far, and wave erosion has sort of worn the coastline back. I'll talk more about the columnar basalt in a minute, but for now I just want to kind of mention some of the surficial processes affecting this coastline. So particularly in the wintertime, big powerful storm waves sort of beat against the base of this cliff and cause rock falls. And so what happens with time is the cliff face will retreat inland. But what's kind of interesting is that the cliff face, it doesn't wear back to a shallower angle with time, it just moves backward parallel to itself. So that's a process called sea cliff retreat. It's a pretty coarse beach. This is gravelly material. That's an Icelandic kroner for scale. That's 100 kroner. That's about $8, roughly. A little larger than the size of a quarter. And the reason I wanted to show this is just make a very important point about geologic science in general. And that is that another kind of fundamental idea in geology is that we calibrate our understanding of the past in terms of what's happening in the present. Very, very important if you're a geologist. It's sometimes said that the best geologist is the one who's seen the most rocks. So what kind of struck me about this beach is you can kind of get a sense that the shapes of the grains are kind of hockey puck shaped. They're not round like you'd see in a river. They're kind of flattened like a hockey puck. And what that indicates is beach processes. You have waves sort of crashing against the beach, waves and tides going in and out. It flops the rocks like pancakes on the beach, and over thousands of years it kind of wears them into a hockey puck shape. So it's a good example of sort of what what the sediment looks like on a modern beach in some cases, if it's a gravelly beach, so that as a geologist, when I see this shape of particle in the geologic record, that tells me, oh, that maybe was a beach at one time, an ancient beach. Okay, so back to these columnar joints. Most of these are six-sided. And by the way, I'm on sabbatical this semester. I'm taking a volcanology class at San Diego State. And something I learned just last week is essentially everything in this picture is a single flow. It's a single lava flow. And what's happening is you have this very, very thick lava flow. And it's thick enough that as it cools, it develops shrinkage cracks, kind of intersecting shrinkage cracks that cut through the thickness of the flow and break it up into these amazing basaltic columns. So that's what we're looking at here. We've got three-sided and four-sided and five-sided, and the most common one is six-sided columns. And you know, what kind of a self-respecting geologist would I be if I didn't bring along my spouse for scale? these photographs. So this poor gentleman was walking around in Reykjavik, and he had a gigantic piece of columnar basalt kind of land on his head. This is just a statue, and the point I was going to make is something I didn't realize until I got to Iceland, is this columnar basalt is really, really common. You see it all over Iceland in many, many different lava flows. And it's also been kind of an architectural inspiration for Icelanders. So this is just a sculpture that we just ran across randomly one day walking around downtown Reykjavik. And this is an amazing cathedral. It used to be the tallest structure in Reykjavik. It's known as the Helgakirkja Church Tower. It's a Lutheran cathedral. And see the motif there, the columnar basalt? This, by the way, is Leif Erikson. So he's saying hello in Icelandic. I'm not even going to pretend to pronounce that. So a way to sort of think about these columnar joints is they're in some ways not too different than mud cracks. When muddy sediment desiccates, it develops these intersecting shrinkage cracks that create these polygonal structures. Essentially, the same thing is happening in one of these lava flows, except that the shrinkage is not due to desiccation, it's due to cooling. So you get these cooling surfaces both on the top and the bottom of the flow, and as the rock cools, it shrinks, and you get these intersecting shrinkage cracks that make for a really dramatic feature. Okay, well, I wanted to just briefly mention a famous eruption that happened in Iceland just a few years ago. Mostly because I wanted to impress you with my Icelandic pronunciation. This was the eruption of the Eyjafjallajökull volcano in 2010. I practiced that for months and I still can't say it right. At San Diego State, where I'm taking this volcanology class, actually one of the people in the class is Icelandic. And after trying to say this for months, I said, oh, is this how you say Eyjafjallajökull? He just sort of looked at me and said, well, no, not really. People would probably know what he meant. An easy way to say that, it's actually sort of an approximate English attempt to say that, is that, hey, you forgot your yogurt. there you go. So I just want to show you some interesting images of the eruption of this kind of smallish volcano beneath the Eyjafjallajökull ice cap. The volcano gets its name from the ice cap. So there's an aerial photograph. One thing that was interesting about this eruption is it really wasn't that big. It was a relatively mild eruption as far as volcanic eruptions go. It wasn't as big as Mount St. Helens, and it wasn't nearly as big as Mount Pinatubo in 1991. But there were a number of factors that sort of came together to disrupt air traffic around the world for about a week or so. This is the ash plume from the volcano, and you can see it affected several continents. One of the main reasons why it was in some ways a more explosive eruption than maybe was anticipated is the volcano, before it erupted, was underneath 200 meters of glacial ice. It was literally a volcano underneath the glacier. And as the volcano began to erupt, it catastrophically melted the glacier above it. And some of that created these massive, what are called hokolups, glacial outburst floods. But the other thing it did is some of that melted glacier water, it fell back into the throat of the volcano like water down a drain. And you can imagine what's going to happen when you take water and mix it catastrophically with magma that's maybe 1,000 degrees centigrade. You're going to get catastrophic steam eruptions. So it's probably best to think of this as more of a hydrovolcanic eruption than simply a volcanic eruption. But the other thing I learned about this eruption is, so it sent up this eruption column, you know, up into the stratosphere, and but it just so happened that the jet stream at the time of the eruption was directly over the volcano. And so when the eruptive column hit the jet stream, it just spread out all of that material for thousands of kilometers, and it ended up disrupting air traffic on both sides of the Atlantic. Upwards of 5 million people were stranded because of the eruption. Almost 100,000 flights were canceled. And just to make a quick point, more and more we're recognizing as geoscientists that nothing happens in isolation. So in this case, we had a geospheric disruption, namely a volcanic eruption. That affected the atmosphere. It created these glacial outburst floods. So that would be the hydrosphere. And because of it essentially brought commercial plane traffic to a standstill for about a week, it affected the biosphere, namely us. So I think the take-home message was nicely summarized by John Muir. When we try to pick out anything by itself, we find it hitched to everything else in the universe. All right, well, some other weird volcanic landforms that I had no idea existed before I got to Iceland. You see these all over Iceland, and I was really puzzled. What are these sort of tallish volcanic plateaus? It turns out they're called table mountains, and they're a type of landform that develops when you have a subglacial eruption. So when this volcano first began to erupt, kind of like Eyjafjallajökull, it erupted underneath ice. And then what happens as the volcano erupts is the edifice of the ice itself kind of confines the eruption. And so rather than kind of spreading out into maybe a shield volcano, because this lava is really hot and runny, normally it would just kind of spread out, the glacial ice sort of confines it, and so it kind of builds up rather than out. And eventually, the volcano does sort of stick up above the ice, and you get a temporary lake with the volcano in the middle. And then if the volcanic eruption continues, the eruptive material fills up the lake and kind of creates a cap that you're seeing right there. So kind of interesting, called the Table Mountain. These were really, really strange. This is an aerial photograph of what sure looked to me like cinder cones, a typical typical cinder cone volcano. But it turns out they're not. And the next slide I'm going to show you is one that I took. It's right in this area, kind of taken from the road. These are known as pseudo craters, also called rootless cones. And what they are, what's weird about them, is you won't find a magma chamber underneath this volcano. There's no sort of subsurface conduit leading to a blob of molten rock underneath. Instead, what's happening here is just a few thousand years ago, there was a lava flow that poured into this kind of wet, marshy area on a lake shore, on the shore of Lake Leebaugh. And you get these localized steam eruptions happening underneath the lava flow. It essentially flashes the moist ground to steam. You get these explosive sort of hydrovolcanic features that blow out both some of the lava and also the surrounding sediment. So they're actually not cinder cones. You won't find, you wouldn't be able to descend into the volcano like the thing you hear volcano. These are just a couple of other people on the tour. And what we're looking at here is not a great example. It's known locally as the church. It's actually a partially collapsed lava tube. Really, really common features are essentially caves that develop on the flanks of certain types of volcanoes. So kind of what happens here, you can sort of picture this. In the early stages of a lava flow, you have all these separate ribbons of lava that are kind of running down the flanks of the volcano. And just like water, they eventually concentrate into larger channels. So there's the hot lava in the channel. It sort of you have cold rock on either side. So initially we have channel ice flow. And then what happens is the lava begins to cool, but it cools more rapidly along the bottoms and the sides and the top of the flow, because that's where it's in contact with cold material, cold air and cold ground. So you essentially get this solidification. You have this central core of hot rock that, and the lava in this case would still be flowing. And now you might think that maybe as the eruption proceeds, perhaps this would just turn to solid material and you'd have kind of a plug of lava. But what actually happens is when the eruption stops, this central flowing tube, it just empties out. So it kind of creates this central pocket that can, in some cases, be tens of miles long. So lots of lava tubes on the island. And as I mentioned, once the lava drains out, you get a nice lava tube. Okay, so on to another feature that totally surprised me, waterfalls. We all know what a waterfall is. It's essentially just a place where water falls over a cliff, where the slope called the gradient of the stream increases dramatically. The waterfalls in Iceland are absolutely amazing. They're every bit as spectacular as where you see them in New Zealand, for example. So I'm going to just show you a few waterfall pictures that I took. But just to kind of look at the sorts of processes geologically that are happening. Sometimes you have the edge of a really deep valley, particularly a glacial valley, where streams on the top kind of flow over the lip of the valley. So that's one way to get a waterfall in Iceland. Another way is if you have one of these big, thick, columnar jointed lava flows, and streams on top can kind of flow over the edge of the flow. And then sometimes where you fracture and shear and pulverize the rock, later stream activity will erode that material through the fault zone, and you'll get a waterfall that way. And as I showed you before, in southern Iceland, sea cliffs can form waterfalls as well. Imagine water sort of flowing over the lip of the sea cliff near the coast. That too would give you a waterfall. And then geologically, what sometimes is the case is if we now add stratigraphy, if we add layering to these processes, sometimes we get a situation where we have softer rock underneath harder rock. And so as the water kind of plunges over the falls, it's able to more quickly erode the softer rock underneath, and it kind of carves out this this deep bowl-shaped depression called a plunge pool. And then what happens with time, as the plunge pool kind of eats away this way, you end up undermining the cliff, and then the whole cliff can catastrophically give way, and the waterfall will move back. So this is a really interesting waterfall, Cellulanthos. And this is kind of a long exposure I took, so you can kind of see the people a little bit blurry. That's actually the same person right there. And the amazing thing about the Cellulanthos waterfall is you can actually walk behind it. So I'm taking this picture, you know, from maybe 50 yards out in front of the waterfall. But this is a picture my wife took from inside the waterfall, kind of looking out. So I got to tell you, this picture that Naomi took really pissed me off, because I have this great, you know, $1,000 camera, pretty good picture, you know, a lot of exposure. She takes a quick shot with her cell phone from the inside of the waterfall that I think is even more spectacular. So that's not her right there, but you can kind of see the people sort of walking through back behind. So that's about where Naomi was standing when she took that picture. And again, that's an ancient sea cliff. What's happening is, since the last ice age, the entire island of Iceland is kind of slowly, buoyantly rising. And so the base of the sea cliff several thousand years ago used to be right at sea level. It's now been uplifted and isolated. This is Iceland's largest waterfall. And if you include Iceland with Europe, it's often described as the largest waterfall in Europe as well, the Gullfoss waterfall. I'm pretty far away here. You can kind of see people walking along the trail. But really, really spectacular. In this case, there's a fault zone. So the rock in this area has been kind of sheared and broken and polarized a little bit, so it's more easily eroded by streams. That's one interpretation. The other possibility is we might be seeing here the results of these massive glacial outburst floods. So sometimes, as I mentioned, what happens is you get a subglacial eruption. A volcano actually erupts underneath ice. It catastrophically melts the ice. Where's all that water going to go? Well, some of it maybe pours back into the volcano and everything goes boom. But what else can happen is the water catastrophically runs downstream to create a massive flood called a hopala. And so there's some researchers that think that this deep gorge here is in part maybe there because the rock is more easily erodible along the fault zone, but it might also be that this gorge has experienced multiple glacial outburst floods in the past. And just another picture of Rolfoss in the fault zone. That's kind of a long exposure I took there, so things look kind of risky. And in this case, there's a geologic control, softer rock underneath and harder rock on top. Actually, I was wrong. This is actually Europe's and Iceland's largest waterfall. This is the Dettifoss waterfall. So I took this shot. I'm way, way far back, and then this is just a close-up shot that I grabbed off the internet to kind of give you a sense of the scale of the waterfall. Probably my favorite waterfall in Iceland. This is known as the Skógafoss waterfall. What's so amazing about it is you can literally walk right up to it. It's this kind of broad plain, gravelly river plain, and I'm kind of standing far back so I get a good shot, but you can literally walk right up to the base of the falls, as close as you dare get. Really, really amazing. And then this is Black Falls in kind of southeastern Iceland, known as Svartafoss. And hey, guess what that is? You recognize that from before? This is columnar jointing. Essentially shrinkage cracks in the cooling lava flow, and we also have a waterfall kind of cascading down over the edge of the flow. And Godafoss, this is in northern Iceland. So interesting legend behind the Godafoss waterfall. Remember a number of slides ago I mentioned that Thingvellir National Park is right on the plate boundary. Well, it turns out that same location holds a lot of cultural and political significance for Icelanders. For over 1,000 years, Icelandic chieftains have met there, right along the plate boundary, to kind of haggle out disputes and discuss Icelandic law. And it was around the year 1000 when the decision was made as a country to convert to Christianity. And in terms of the little bit of history that I've read, apparently, at that point, it was very controversial. Iceland was on the verge of civil war. And on the one hand, you had the pagans, who obviously weren't interested at all in Christianity, and you had Christians who wanted to make Iceland officially a Christian nation. And so these Icelandic chieftains got together at Thingvellir, and they essentially reached a political compromise. And what they said was, okay, officially, you know, on the books, we're going to make Iceland a Christian nation, but you pagans, you know, if you don't make a big deal about it, you know, still practice your paganism, you can, you know, eat horse meat, do whatever you want to do as pagans, that's okay. So it was kind of a compromise decision to prevent Iceland from sort of degenerating into civil war. And so as the legend goes, one of the chieftains who was instrumental in reaching this compromise traveled directly from Thingvellir to Godafoss waterfall, and he dumped his pagan idols in the falls to kind of signify his at least on paper, devotion to Christianity. So what's interesting is you can still see some of the idols kind of floating around in the water today. It's really amazing. It's kind of subtle if you sort of look in the mist at the base of the waterfalls. Can you kind of see what I'm talking about? Can you kind of see any of the pagan idols? Yeah, there's one right about there. There it is. So that's one of those. That's one of those pagan idols that's still kind of floating around the base of the fall. We went to this waterfall on purpose in the morning, so I'm kind of looking west. The sun is kind of rising behind me. Beautiful rainbow was formed, in a picturesque way in front of the fall. I didn't Photoshop that in. That's an actual rainbow. This is the leader of the trip. His family. And just very quickly, I'm going to get out of my depth real quickly in terms of physics, but essentially what's happening is sunlight is kind of being filtered through raindrops, and internally it's being bent and it's also bouncing within the raindrops. and different colors, different wavelengths of light will bend at different angles, and you'll get a process called dispersion. Same thing happens in a prism. When white light is passed through a prism, it kind of fans out the different colors, and that's essentially what you're seeing. The millions of raindrops, in this case the mist from the waterfall, all of those droplets are acting like little tiny prisms to create these this beautiful rainbow. Okay, so on to a few geothermal features. I'll take you to Blue Lagoon, which was kind of a spa, really, really amazing, and then we'll go to the Strokor Geyser, and then up to some mud ponds. Do you see any pattern here in terms of where these geothermal features are occurring? Of course, right along the plate boundary in the western and northern rift zones. Not too surprising, because all of Iceland is being torn apart there. Okay, this is the Blue Lagoon. Kind of a touristy place, but it was really, really fun. If you ever find yourself in Iceland, it's totally worth it to go to the Blue Lagoon. It's only about half an hour from the airport. And you wouldn't know it, they don't really publicize this, but actually what you're swimming in is the outfall water, kind of the wastewater from a geothermal power plant. It's not dirty, it's not contaminated. It's full of tiny, tiny submicroscopic what are called colloidal particles of silica, SiO2. And it turns out they're just the right size to reflect bluish light. So you see this all over Iceland, the geothermal pools as well. So that's the natural color of the pools. And just a couple of shots. It's pretty interesting. So you go in and you pay a bunch of money, it's not cheap. And they give you this bracelet, this electronic bracelet, and then that's your currency for the rest of the day. You walk around in your bathing suit, and hey, if you want to swim up to the swim-up bar, you just flash your bracelet, and they put it on your bill. If you want a massage, you just flash your bracelet. If you want a meal, you just flash your bracelet. So it seems great at the time. You're like, yeah, I'll take that. And you pay the piper at the end of the day, you have a $200 bill. But it's totally worth it. There's Naomi, so she has my wife. She has what they have kind of around the pool in different places is they have these pots of pure silica. It's SiO2. And you rub it on your face, and then it hardens kind of like a crust. And so everybody is doing that. And then I'll call your attention to what she's drinking. She elected to be non-alcoholic. And so she got this sort of like a slush beverage. And it's called crap. You've seen this all over Iceland, so there's a blue-green color. So how cool is that? You have crap at the Blue Lagoon. So that's what we did. Okay, so onto the Strokor Geyser and some of the geothermal pools. Geysers are really interesting. They're somewhat rare. You only see them in maybe a couple of dozen places on planet Earth. And you really need sort of three different geologic features all coming together in just the right way to form a geyser. You certainly need a source of geothermal heat. Not a problem in Iceland. We're pulling apart those two plates and allowing heat from Earth's interior to leak up to the surface. You also need groundwater. It's very wet in Iceland. Iceland gets a lot of rain, and so that's not a problem either. And then perhaps most importantly, you need an internal plumbing system of just the right structure to create a geyser. And so here I am at the Strokor Geyser. This is a photograph I took just in the moment before the geyser erupted. And it took me, I'm going to kind of show you a sequence here. So in this case, when the water pressure internally, when it exceeds the confining pressure, sort of holding the water back, when that inequality becomes true, you get this catastrophic jet of hot water called a geyser. So to go from that to a full-blown eruption takes less than a second. And it was really challenging to get these photographs. These are not all from the same eruption. These are like from 10 different eruptions. It's almost as if the geyser knows that it's being photographed. On average, the Strokor Geyser would erupt maybe every 6-8 minutes, but it's not regular. Sometimes you get two eruptions back to back 30 seconds. Sometimes you go 15 minutes with no eruption. So of course, everybody sees the eruption, including me. You get your camera ready, and you're holding it, and holding it, and holding it. Your arms are getting tired, and then you look away just for a second, and the geyser erupts. So what I learned after several cycles is, boy, the other mistake I made, see this sort of mound of water that signals that the eruption is imminent. It's going to happen in less than a second. So my next problem was, okay, I see the mound, there it is, click. By then, you know, it's over. And so it took me 5 or 10 cycles to realize that even before my conscious mind is recognizing that the geyser is going to erupt, the second I see that mound, I just push down the shutter, click, 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 click. And yeah, so that's how I was able to sort of get this nice eruption sequence. But I didn't take video myself, but there are kind of some spectacular videos I want to show you on YouTube. You'll see what I mean, how fast this occurs. So really spectacular. Notice what's happening to a lot of the water. It's sort of draining back into the geyser, and then it takes a while for new hot water to kind of fill the geyser back up. And that's kind of a close-up. If you stand back, you kind of get a better shot of the scale, kind of the vertical scale of this Trophore geyser when it erupts. I should mention as well that the word geyser comes from the geyser next to the Trophore geyser. And historically, the geyser has been really, really active, but in the last few decades, it's kind of been less active. So nowadays, when people go to see a geyser eruption, they're not actually looking at the geyser, they're looking at the Trophore geyser kind of right next to it. Just some more geothermal pools, really, really beautiful. There's natural silica in the water, which is why it's that beautiful bluish. And then, these features are called mud pots. Where I am right here is I'm in the northern volcanic zone, so essentially I'm on the plate boundary. You can see that person is actually straddling the plate boundary. And I did want to kind of make a connection with San Diego geology. So I lied a little bit when I said that Iceland is the only place on Earth where you can stand on top of a divergent plate boundary. It turns out you can do it in the Salton Sea as well, about 3 hours east of here. The difference, though, is that the actual mid-ocean ridge that you would normally see just south of the Salton Sea, it's buried by lake sediments and river sediments and Colorado River sediments. So in some ways, you can walk across it. You just don't know you're walking across it. It's buried beneath a thick pile of sediment, whereas Iceland, the structure of the ridge actually sticks up above sea level. But the connection with San Diego geology is there are several places on sort of the southern shore of the Salton Sea where you can see mud pots. The two geologic and plate tectonic environments are similar, so in a way it kind of makes sense that we would see similar geologic features. So this is called a fumarole. A fumarole is just a gas vent. Anywhere where gases from Earth's interior leak out into the atmosphere is called a fumarole. Mostly what we're seeing here is water vapor. In fact, that's the main gas that drives pretty much all volcanic eruptions. And then in addition to water vapor, we get lesser amounts of carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, and also significantly hydrogen sulfide. So you walk around this area, it doesn't smell pretty. It has a rotten egg smell. And the thing that's so interesting about this particular fumarole, you can't tell because I sort of cropped them out of the picture. People are lined up a dozen thick to walk through the... Wow, I did it too. It's kind of cool. So that's what this person is doing. And of course, the other thing about Iceland is it's a really, really essentially pollution-free country. It really, really is fresh air, except when you're walking through a fumarole or even, among other things, hydrogen and sulfur. If this person wants to breathe fresh air, all they would really need to do would be to go to a gift shop, because you can actually buy canned air at these Icelandic gift shops. I think that was pretty cool. Talk about a marketing genius. Guess what you find inside these canisters? Absolutely nothing. Well, I guess that's not true. You find Icelandic air. Okay, so I just kind of want to finish up my talk tonight with a few sort of glacial landforms. All the geologists are going, wow, that's really cool. It's sort of a classic textbook example of a U-shaped glacial valley. Until a few thousand years ago, Iceland, essentially the entire island, looked like Greenland does today. It was under, you know, hundreds of meters to kilometers of ice. And as these ice sheets slowly sort of move outward towards the towards sea level under their own weight, they carve, especially when they get near the coast, they kind of concentrate into valley glaciers, these sort of narrow tongues of ice, and they erode these dramatic U-shaped glacial valleys. And then what's been happening just in the last few thousand years after the glaciers receded is now river erosion is sort of notching the glacial valleys and kind of turning them back into V-shaped river valleys. So this is a drowned glacial valley. This is actually very deep water. It's known as a fjord. And then up there in the hillside is actually a birthplace of a mountain glacier or a valley glacier. It's known as a cirque. It's a beautiful kind of textbook example. Another fjord. What you can't see because I cropped it out is a big cruise ship right off of here. But this was just kind of a dramatic landscape. So notice that everything kind of below these craggy peaks is somewhat smooth. That's what glacial erosion tends to do. It tends to kind of smooth out the landscape due to the erosive effect of all of the ice kind of grinding against rock surfaces. So to a geologist, what these sort of craggy peaks indicate is that at the height of the last ice age, the ice probably extended up to here, but just below the tips of the peaks. These would have been, you know, isolated peaks that poked up through the ice sheets that weren't glaciated. So speaking of Icelandic cuisine, what's on the menu? Well, we have grilled minke whale, if that interests you. And if you're not into whale, you can always try the puffin. Puffin is an Arctic bird. And if that doesn't interest you, you can always try fermented shark. And I wasn't about to eat the whale, no thanks. I paid money to go whale watching. I wasn't about to whale. And same with puffins. I'll show you a picture of a puffin in a minute. They're really beautiful kind of Arctic birds. I wasn't about to eat one. I'm a little bit regretful that I didn't try the marinated shark, the fermented shark, but from talking to other people, it's an accomplishment if you can get it down without retching. Interesting Icelandic cuisine. This was from a wonderful kind of pub that my wife and I found. We went back several times. The fish and chips were just amazing. Some of the best fish I've ever had in Iceland. So there's a picture of a puffin. This was one of about maybe 500 pictures that I took of puffins. It's crazy. So I took this on a day that I went whale watching. I've seen lots of whales, so that didn't interest me, but they mentioned that, well, as a bonus, you can also see puffin. I'd never seen a puffin before, so that sounded pretty cool. So at the beginning of the journey, we went to this big island that was offshore called Puffin Island, where thousands of puffin were just flying in circles around the island. But it was hard to photograph them. They just looked like little dots. Some of the puffin were in the water, and kind of like the guys here, I swear they knew you were trying to take their picture, so they'd be looking at you. You know, I'd line up my camera, I'd zoom in with my zoom lens, get the light just right, and right before I snap that damn shutter, the puffin would like do a 180. And so I have like 498 pictures of puffin butts. Only two decent pictures of puffin, but they're a pretty spectacular bird. Well, this is, when we first saw this is a picture I took from the boat. The guy said that it was a blue whale. And which was kind of amazing. And just to give you a sense of the scale here, you know, that it almost looks like a dolphin, right? Not that impressive. Except when you stop and consider that what you're actually looking at is that much of a whale. But then the guide, a few minutes later, she came back on the loudspeaker and she said, oh, my mistake. Actually, this is not a blue whale at all. Example of a fin blue whale hybrid. I'm thinking, how did they know that? You know, did they recognize the markings as the shape of the fin? And she went on to explain that they actually are familiar with this individual whale. They've sampled its DNA, which is how they know it's a rare hybrid. It's a little bit of whale hanky-panky going on there in the waters off Iceland. Okay, so just the last few slides I want to show you are glacial features related to the Batlyokul ice sheet. This volcano erupts from time to time. This is the Grimsbotn volcano, and when it erupts, it's highly explosive because most of the volcano is under ice. And so when it erupts, it catastrophically melts the ice, and you get these massive glacial outburst floods. So an example of a glacier, this kind of ribbon of sediment is known as a medial moraine. And then this pile of sediment at the toe of the glacier is what happens as the glacier moves down, and then it melts and kind of dumps its sediment load. So a nice example of the medial moraine and the end moraine. What we're seeing here might not look spectacular. It's known as a glacial outwash plain or a sander plain. The largest sander plains on Earth occur in Iceland. So that was pretty spectacular. And as I'll kind of get into, these don't form from sort of everyday streams that carry sediment out onto the plain. They typically form occasionally when you get these catastrophic glacial outburst floods that deposit tons and tons of sediment all at once in a single event. So again, just a quick video clip I wanted to show you to kind of give you a sense of scale of these coculas. This is one that happened in the late 90s after the eruption of the Grimsbotn volcano. Good counterpoint to the notion that geologic processes happen slowly over long periods of time. I mean, that's often true, but frankly, most of the material that you're looking at, it wasn't deposited by the streams that you see. It was deposited in these massive glacial outburst floods, these coculas. That's an example of just some steel bridge material that was taken out during the recent coculas. We took a tour, we actually went in the water into a coastal lagoon filled with icebergs. Some of these glaciers make it all the way to the sea, and then they calve, and you have all of these icebergs sort of floating around in the lagoon water. And that's our group. We're getting on these really, really interesting Soviet-style amphibious vehicles. And literally, all they did is they just drove into the water. The transport becomes a boat. Pretty cool. They're just some images of these amazing icebergs out in the Yokulorsong lagoons. And that's one of my favorite pictures. You can kind of see the glaciers bringing the ice into the lagoon. It's a very black and white landscape. And this was one of the people on the trip. Her name was Michaela. And she was Canadian. And then one night we heard her speaking this strange language. We said, "What language is that?" And she said, "Oh, well, I'm half Chechnyan." She's actually fluent in Chechnya. And so I just happened to take this photo at just the right time. I caught it perfectly. Not really. This is like the 15th attempt. And at this point, she was kind of getting bored and just trying to take the picture. Well, that's about all I have to say. I'll just end with a shot of this sander plane, the largest on Earth. And then a quote from one of my favorite poets, Robert Service. He didn't write this in reference to Iceland, but it certainly applies to Iceland, you know, the land of the midnight sun. So, I want to thank everybody for coming tonight, and happy to entertain any questions. But I hope everyone gets a chance to visit Iceland at some point in their life. It was really a life-changing experience. I can't wait to go back. Thank you.